exactly what role do you have at the festival?
Coordinating the entire festival. So that basically means outsourcing and getting everybody else to do my work.
What did you think of the opening, Phil?
I loved it, yeah. I knew a couple of people in it. It was great.
Really?
Yes.
What, some of the actors?
Yeah, in Independently Blue, yeah.
Tomorrow night we've got Bent, and we've pretty much sold out of Bent. That's the Jude Law, Rupert Graves, Mick Jagger in drag number. That's the Germany post-war.
There's quite a good deal of queer behaviour here in the foyer this year.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes.
We've got Chained Girls, a 60s documentary, which is hilarious on how lesbians really live back in the 60s.
I think it's extraordinary how they're showing all these different types of lesbians now.
I know. There's lots of types of lesbians.
Now, are you regular patrons of the film festival?
First time.
Really?
We've only been in Melbourne for a year.
Where do you come from?
Queensland, Brisbane.
Melbourne Star Observer, the Also Foundation, Avant Card, STA Travel.
Well, I've just gotten to Australia, actually, and thought that it would be the best way to get into the culture here.
Now, what's to be the highlight of the festival for you this year?
Probably Frisk.
Brother, Sister, yeah. Nova Cinemas, George Cinemas, and the list goes on. An extraordinary list of sponsors.
And they've all just come on board?
Oh, with a bit of hard work, a bit of push and shove, but no, they've come on board to support what's going to be a fantastic 9-day festival of quality queer film.
Well, you know, the film in there was an American film, the feature film. Is that representative of all the lesbians and gay men?
They wouldn't let me watch it. They made me prepare champagne.
I've heard that you're quite shy in front of the camera.
I'm terribly shy.
But I find this hard to believe because you make such wonderful movies. What brings you down to Melbourne then?
Just a change of lifestyle. Like.
Well, what's in the pipeline for you? You can't say.
Oh yeah, I can say.
Oh, do.
I'm doing a film of William Yang's show Sadness, a documentary for the ABC.
So you've come again this year.
Yes.
Did you buy one of those season tickets, or are you just going to see bits and pieces?
Bits and pieces, yeah, pick and choose.
What is it about the Queer Film Festival that you find enthralling and keeps you coming back for more?
Need I say?
You did the little trailer here.
I did, yes.
Now, it was all about chocolate and kind of body parts.
Chocolate and nudity.
What did you think of this film here, the feature film tonight? Be honest.
The audience liked it.
Oh, that's always a good sign.
My flatmate, although he's Australian, didn't think so and was really surprised people were laughing so much during the film. He said he thought that it was inappropriately homophobic.
Now, what else is in the pipeline for you, young man? Because you are a very talented filmmaker.
I don't know. Every year I keep saying, you know, I've made a trailer, I've got to make a short film, so hopefully a short film.
Have you noticed any films on the program this year that have caught your attention?
Frisk, I think. I read the book. Yes. And well, I'd be interested to see how it converts to film.
Loved the little short one. It was very artistic. But the long one was just so camp, it was wonderful.
Wasn't it camp?
Oh, magic.
Aren't they strange, those American lesbians?
Pillow talk, pillow talk, another night of hearing myself talk, 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 talk.
You know, everyone likes cartoons and, you know, it's memories of childhood and it's very accessible for everyone. And using that as a vehicle to get things that usually aren't seen across, because, I mean, there's many different ways you can present a certain subject matter. You know, you could present it really vulgar, you know, and that's sort of really in your face. This is a photograph of, you know, genitals or something like that. Or you can sort of, I think the best way to describe what I tend to do with my work is sort of I use people's aesthetics against their ways of thinking. The connection with Bambi, I suppose Disney stands for, I mean, it's a classic example, like Warner Brothers, you know, they stand for all these sort of stereotypical, this is what a man is, this is what a woman is, and I mean, when you're a child, you know, cartoons, we tend to think of, oh yeah, they're cartoons, they're not serious, but you think about what they're implanting into children, you know, traditional notions like good always wins over evil, you know, good triumphs in the end, man and woman together, because I mean, Bambi does find his mate in this, you know. Mm-hmm. And all that sort of thing, there's a lot going on. And I suppose I specifically chose Bambi because he was probably, you know, a bit of a feminine man, you know, gentle yet strong. You know? Even the characters that you look at, you know, in Disney productions or anything like that, they have a certain sort of I mean, beyond the actual meaning that they have, like in terms of stereotypes and that sort of thing, they also have a capture of time. I mean, it was made in, I don't know, like the 50s or something, 50s, 60s. And, you know, what was going on during that time, where, you know, what was the social situation from which these characters were created. So it's got a lot of that in it as well.
All I do is talk to my pillow, talk about the boy I'm gonna marry someday, somehow, somewhere, sometime. Pillow talk, pillow talk, another night I get my fill of pillow talk.
It's one of the few things when people have sort of said to me, oh, you know, you've just sort of put, you know, you've taken two things and just mishmashed them together, anyone can do that. And what they don't realise is that, I mean, I'm sure there are people who do that, but I, with the images and all that, it often goes through this grueling process of trying things out and deliberately playing with things. I mean, for example, with the Meanwhile Another part of the forest paintings, the background, you know, you sort of tend to see homosexuality and all that sort of thing. It is very much in the background. It's far from being mainstream. Yeah, generally, I mean, I'm not really restricted by a style or a medium, and I suppose that's what, I mean, you'll probably see that in the work as well, because they're totally different styles from, you know, one sort of super realistic, one's very blocky and very sort of, you know, paint by numbers. And
right.
So it, style, like I said, I tend to use style as a way of getting things across and juxtaposing things, creating a sense of what the style means, you know, mm-hmm. like why we like to look at things and what the things mean. Mm-hmm. So it's very
so
much
it's really investigation of that aesthetic.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Getting people to look at maybe why they like the things they like, mm-hmm. You know, because it's a fairly big thing. We all know what we like, and it's, you know, we all, you know, we walk into a gallery, instantly we know, oh, I like that red painting over there, I like that one, mm-hmm. and that sculpture catches my eye. And It's a very difficult process, very personal process about discovering exactly what that is that you like.
There must be a boy. There must be a boy. There must be a boy. There must.
You are here at the Queer Film and Video Festival. Have any of the other films on the program caught your attention this year?
No, it's a bit hard. I think this one's a hard act to follow, actually.
Yeah, and you did have a good time with it.
Oh, hilarious. Great.
How about that short film, Independently Blue, which was filmed in Brisbane?
I know, my hometown.
That's a lovely little shirt you have there.
Thank you. Bit of a ruche look happening.
I think it's lovely. How long have you been here in Melbourne?
7 years.
Long time.
It's a long time, yes.
Of course, you work at Hares and Hyenas.
I do indeed, yes.
Now, has anything on the program caught your attention this year in particular?
It's good to see Frisk has actually made an appearance. I've been waiting for it. It's one of my favourite books.
Now, there wasn't a great deal of dialogue in your movie.
It's none.
No dialogue.
No dialogue,
at all.
No dialogue.
So this is deliberate?
Yes, I sort of was working with the themes of the 30s and using silent to tell a story, not using any dialogue, but using music instead.
What was it like working with Mr. Kovsky?
Oh, Barry. Oh, Barry and I. Well, you know, Barry and I are doing a few new productions together next.
What's it about?
Oh, murder and sex. Oh. The things we enjoy most.
It's a short film. It's about love and betrayal, and it's set in the 1930s.
What did you think of the films here this evening?
Oh, it was...
Well, it made me want to move to Queensland, and then it made me want to move to the southern states of America in the second film.
So do you think that was representative of the scene in Brisbane?
No, not at all, I can tell you. That's why I left. I love a lot of the 30s era, the sort of melodramatic style of films then, and Marlene Dietrich, that whole kind of thing.
I didn't actually see the movie anymore because I don't watch movies anymore. I just make them.
How much does something like that cost to make?
To tell you the truth, it cost, I think, about $10,000, but it should have cost, in reality, if we'd paid people, about $100,000. So,
okay, so it was a pretty good deal.
It was a very good team effort.
What was your little film called with Barry?
It was called Pills and Potions, and it was about Rita La Kakita, the most misunderstood drag queen in Melbourne.
Yeah, I did that nipple clampers thing.
That was very good.
Yep, I've got a film this year in the festival called Psychedelic Playboy. It's hot. It's a bisexual fantasy, darling. Mwah.
What did you think of this first movie, The Feature?
I loved Alex. She had excellent taste in lingerie.
I tell you, they really know how to throw a party, these film people, don't they?
Fish and chips are just absolutely divine.
You're one of the volunteers with the Queer Film and Video Festival?
Yes, they really look after you here, make sure everything's going well, and we just basically got the food out and the booze and everyone's happy.
Soho is fantastic. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. There's
lots of coffee shops.
Lots of coffee shops, lots of nightclubs, but London, everything closes at 2 a.m.
They were coming out left, right and centre in that movie.
They were. I couldn't believe it. And the microphone even came out the top. Did you notice that?
I love that. Was my favourite scene.
Really?
It still closes early.
Yes, it does. And so does San Francisco. 2 a.m. I say stay in Australia.
Now you're watching a good movie when you see the boom.
I think so too. Yeah, absolutely.
I just thought I want to write for Savannah because they've really branched out and they're franchising into the queer market now.
A million times I've asked you, and then I ask you over again. You only answer, perhaps, perhaps, perhaps. If you can't make your mind up, we'll never get started.
What's different, Pete, about the 69 that makes it so exciting to you?
2,000 people in a seething, roaring, shouting mass.
All the people I know are musicians. I revolve around music. That's all I know.
I think Sydney has a totally different culture. I mean, I always think of Melbourne as being quite European and multicultural. And although Sydney is quite multicultural too, I think of Sydney as being much more LA. It's more of a white jeans, you know, t-shirt type culture.
I've always been into the performance side of things. To learn the business side has been really important to me as well, you know, in terms of learning, having to know about contracts and legal issues, which frankly would have bored me once, but it's very tiring, you know, having to deal with it all, but it's good to know.
Well, we're just two boys that are out there for a good time, and maybe not a long time, so we're doing what we can.
And
we find that most of the other clubs in the gay scene of Melbourne are pretty much, you know, dominated by celebrities who are already well known, and they're great and we love them, but we find that it's often harder for up and coming talent to find somewhere to perform.
He's wearing velvet pants. He's got a nice body.
Other venues, yeah, where you go and a show comes on and the music all stops and the lights go on and people who are dancing get really annoyed because they have to watch a drag show, which they don't want to watch. You know, in our own club, you can watch shows all night or dance all night or go between both.
It literally fell into our laps, really, and we would have just been, I think we would have been crazy to say no, and we're both, I think, we're into challenges, you know, so it was a perfect opportunity for us.
You know, people like to stand around bars and pubs and sort of, Melbourne's a bit more glamorous and, you know, a bit more into fur and makeup and art and all that sort of great thing.
Well, we basically thought that we wanted music that we knew ourselves would, you know, get up to and just have fun to, and real uplifting music. So when we were searching for DJs, we were, you know, basically DJs who were willing to play really uplifting house, garage, and we'd like a bit of retro in there as well. Because I think it's important to be able to sing along as well when you're dancing.
We love the whole idea of gender, you know, and androgyny and whatever, but we just thought that, you know, people want a bit more these days than just a drag show, so we're, you know, fusing drag with singers and other types of performers. I've been going out for, I don't know, quite some number of years, and it seems to have died lately. I mean, it's just everybody's taking everything so seriously, and it's like, unless you're on steroids and hard drugs and dancing to hardcore techno all night, you kind of feel a bit alienated. We're planning on, you know, showcasing the work of young artists on the walls. Say we'll have an opening and for an art show earlier in the evening, and then the club will open up later. so that, you know, young artists who may find it hard to get gallery space at more commercial venues can get their work out there.
Well, we're aiming at a real mixed, like cross-the-board clientele, really. I mean, you know, boys and girls.
And everything in between, young and old. Anyone who wants to watch a great show or alternatively go and dance all night to some great music, basically we've got you all covered.
And we're pretty excited that, you know, it is sort of two worlds in the one venue. You can go and watch a show, or you can just go out and, you know, work that dance floor. So we both share the same wicked sense of humour.
And we just bounce off each other. We have these great ideas all the time. It's like, oh, maybe we should do that, or maybe we should do this. And like, yeah.
So, and in times when like this is all just getting too much for us, you know, where the other one's there to sort of, you know, edge the other one along and come on, you know, get up out of the bed.
I know. Sometimes I'm so tired. And then he'll ring me. It's like, come on, we're going to da-da-da. We've got an appointment with blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh. It's a great venue. It's two large rooms, which one is like a sort of a spaced out dance floor area, and the other one is just a, you know, really chilled out lounge type atmosphere where there'll be, you know, shows and tables and chairs and a couple of pool tables, coffee machine. So it's two very different, you know, environments within the one club. I see people, you know, looking for something a bit more intimate, a bit more relaxed. It's groovy. It's groovy, I guess. And you know what else, Kay? It's a fun club too. Go ahead, and you know what else, Kay? It's gonna fun be a club fun club too.
Change the wording.
Okay.
It's groovy, I
guess.
And you know what else, Kay? It's a fun club too. Okay, one more time.
And you know what else, Kay?
It's a fun club too.
It's gonna be a fun club too.
Firstly, I must say that Alan and David and Craig and Paul and myself, we sit down in January, February, and we talk about what we want to do and a concept. And of course, we've got, everyone is so talented in their own field, as in production, set designing. It's just incredible. And I couldn't, you know, we're one team and we're all very special. And they're special guys and they're just beautiful to work with. We sat around a dining table one night to say that something should happen, because I'm a straight woman and I love all this. I think it's fabulous. And I'd been to a lot in the States, a lot of the functions. And so we formed our fabulous committee.
Oh gosh, now you're doing the whole fantasy ball thing. Now where on earth did you get your lovely frock from?
Well, it was specially made, actually, yeah. So I put the design up in my head and then just put it all down in fabric and off we went.
What's mostly heaven about this little outfit is you have a little bit of glitter on your teeth.
Oh.
Started at the top and worked down?
No, the bottom and worked up. It's the only way.
Oh, yes, absolutely. The only way is up.
Absolutely.
I feel naked, actually.
Do you? Just a little exposed.
Well, this is kind of the first time I've done this.
And you are wearing legs here.
Yeah.
Fabulous. I just love being glamorous and amongst all of these glamorous people.
Can you tell me just quickly, what is this infatuation you have with the fan thing? Where did you get your frock from?
Drag bag in Sydney.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I don't like to buy off the rack, you know.
No.
With a size like mine, it pays just to sort of wrap the material around and sew it up.
I'm from Sydney, yeah. And there's a group of us from Sydney here tonight.
So I'm feeling very pretty tonight.
Tell me about this drag bag store.
Oh, well, drag bag will just do, I'll pretty much do anything.
Will they?
Yeah.
They make their own stuff there, or how does it work?
Yeah, they make their own stuff.
It's because I get hot when I dance.
Okay, so that's your own little air conditioning unit.
Yes.
Do they have such things in Sydney?
Oh, nothing as glamorous as this.
And it is a fundraising activity, isn't it?
It certainly is, yes.
So tonight we're raising funds for
McFarlane Burnett Cancer Institute. No, it's Cancer Research HIV. And in our funds that we have over on the night, we do give to them. We supported also for the first few years of our time, I suppose we went for 5 or 6 years with that, and then we decided to go independent and give to people 100%. So we gave to the San Michele Home, and that is a home for men and boys living and don't have a home that are living with AIDS, and they have a beautiful home.
How many chickens died for that headdress?
Look, I'm keeping steggles in chickens for weeks.
Did you sew all these yourself?
On the Mitsubishi, yeah.
Mitsubishi. Levi, how lovely it is to bump into you.
Well, I'm a judge.
I've worked it out, and it's about equal to about having 4 litres of milk on top of your head.
Was there any particular thought behind the theme here with all the lace and all?
We wanted to dress as men, but find out which era the men wore the most makeup.
Obviously, you're no stranger to the fantasy ball.
I've been a couple of times. I enjoy it. It's fun.
Do you know, your whole outfit is fabulous, but I'm particularly taken by your Diamante set here.
Oh.
What's the story behind the jewels?
Charlie Weaver.
Have you had any preliminary thoughts with regards to the costumery here?
I'm looking.
With this sewing machine, is it all computerised?
Actually, it does have computerised, yeah.
So
it has.
You can kind of program in the pattern and it does it all?
No, not quite.
She does have the best, doesn't she?
Look, from London, I believe, and it's just like, you can't get them anywhere else.
But you have a little bit of Diamante here as well.
Yes, I know. I've always been partial to a bit of sparkle.
What criteria do we use?
I'm judging novelty.
Where did you all buy it from?
No, that would be telling.
So something that's very novel.
Yes, something fun.
So you get to wear trousers and makeup.
And makeup.
Well, that was my thought as I came as a lesbian. Now tell me.
I think we've had the most incredible highlights with the Jeannie Littles, the Rhonda Birchmores, the Tony Lamonts, the Ross Givingtons, and it just goes on that these people give their time. Oh, I just, you know, you like to thank the people who attend, the people who make part of the night, the costuming, the judges. You know, it's just everything in general. I mean, we couldn't have this if we don't have the patrons.
Are you a little bit attached to black feathers these days?
Love them.
And what are you eating?
It's a pasta, vegetarian pasta.
Hey, how long did it take to paint your face?
About 2 hours.
Now, where did you get your clothes from?
Through some friends who made them, Brett and Rick.
They actually made them?
They made the whole lot, yes, from the Melbourne Follies.
It's quite high, isn't it?
Oh, it's fantastic.
Quite a good deal of fowl have died this evening.
I know, sad, miserable deaths, but such is the price of glamour, really.
Tell me about your outfit here. It's an African fantasy.
Sort of inspired, yeah.
Have you been to Fantasy Ball before?
No, it's my first time, actually. I think it's fantastic. We need to come more.
Hey, tell me, what's the dish on the food?
It's okay.
Okay.
Yeah, think airlines.
A bit like an airline?
Yeah.
Maybe Pam Ann's floating around somewhere. Have you matched up your contact lenses with your outfit, especially for this evening?
Oh, you can say yeah.
We're going to do a few circumcisions, actually.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, you see?
Yes, indeed.
Yes, $10 a throw.
I'm interested in tribal art, so that's always something I'm not interested in just straight drag. I like to be a bit more inventive.
Oh, I think we'll look fantastic and we could go more.
Gosh, you look like you're having such a good time.
We sure. And we are.
Oh,